Hey guys, thank you so much for tuning in today. First of all, I just want to thank you so much for all your comments. Please keep them coming since it really, really encourages me to make more of these videos. I also want to help you guys learn as much as you can, so I've actually created a dedicated Facebook page where you can post your work or post any questions you might have for the community to answer. We're all on this XR journey together, so please like and subscribe and join our Facebook page so we can continue to make cool shit together. Anyway, here's your video. So far, we've used a list of components provided by Aframe, such as geometry, color, lighting. These are really, really basic components. So what if we want to make something more custom? The great thing about Aframe is that it's built on top of WebGL, 3JS, and JavaScript. So what this actually means is that you can build on top of Aframe to essentially expand the framework. So today, what we're gonna do is write our own component. If you don't know the basics of JavaScript, you might struggle a little bit, but I'll try my best to make it as easy as possible. First of all, let's make sure we're on the same page by defining exactly what an entity and a component is. What is an entity? It's simply a container that encapsulates a 3D object and all its functions. Its job is to simply keep everything that belongs together in one container. Think of it like the human skin. Without our skin, all our brains and organs and everything would just fall out. So, in conclusion, think of entity as a container and nothing else. Okay, so then what is a component? The container is the skin, or the entity is the skin. Then components would be our organs. So everything else that is not our skin that makes us who we are, including our personality, height, all of that is a component. So for this example, I'm gonna say that the component is our blood. Together, entities and component make up the entity component system architecture. The whole idea behind the setup is to make sure that we can make reusable components that can be used across a variety of entities. So if you take the human body as an example, you can say that we all have the same organs, right? So we all have the same components, but how those components look is going to be slightly different to one another. For example, all humans have blood, but we all have different blood types. Hopefully that makes sense. If you look under the hood of a single component, you've got the name of the component, then you've got what's called the schema, and you've got what we're going to call lifecycle methods. The schema is just an object that stores data. So remember that. All it does is store data. The lifecycle methods uses the data from the schema to do something when the method is called. So essentially, a schema is the anatomy of a component and the lifecycle methods are its physiology. Now, I'm not going to take you through all the lifecycle methods because for the most part, you can just read it on the documentation. For this set of tutorials, we're just going to look at the most important ones. Init is called once the component is initialized. It's used to set up the initial state and instantiate the variables. Again, if you compare that to the human body, it's essentially when a human is born. Update is called for both when the component is initialized and whenever any of the component's properties is updated via a set attribute. Again, comparing to the human body, it's basically what happens when you learn new information. So for example, my sister comes up to me and she tells me, "Hey Clary, I got a stain on your favorite white shirt." I update information in my head that my shirt is now stained, and then my update function gets called. It basically triggers my response to how I'm gonna respond to that information. The last one that we're gonna look at is actually the tick function, and it's called on each render loop or tick of the scene. To put it simply, the tick function runs continuously. It contains the task that that component needs to do on every frame. Again, comparing it to the human body, what do we need to do every once in a while? We need to blink, we need to breathe, and our heart needs to beat. Otherwise, we probably will not survive. This lesson's getting pretty dark. If none of this makes sense to you yet, don't worry, it will very soon. So guys, let's start coding. I'm gonna start by opening up a glitch project, and I've actually already set it up here. All I've got so far is just a scene with a single red box. We're gonna add our very own component to this box. To do that, I'm gonna go to the Aframe docs, and I'm gonna copy over this entire template and then stick it here between the script tags. So with components, it is recommended that you put it in a different JavaScript file and then you just pull it into your code with script tags. But in this tutorial, I'm just gonna do it the dirty way just so it's easier for me to explain to you without having to switch files. Anyway, I've pasted this in now and I'm gonna click prettier to format the whole thing and voila, great. So now we've got the schema and we've got all the lifecycle methods, but for this lesson, we're not gonna look at all of these lifecycle methods. So we're gonna delete everything except init. The first thing I'm gonna do is prove that this component actually works. So I'm gonna call it blood. And then I want it to do one thing, and that's to just print itself out. So in the init function, I am gonna go console.log and type in hello, I am blood. And then I'm gonna plug in this component into the entity that I've set up. Now, if I rerun this code, go preview, open it in a new window, close all of these, inspect, and go console, it prints out, hello, I am blood. Again, let's reiterate why this works. Essentially, the init function gets called when an entity is born. So if you can imagine, the code is running, this entity is born, and what it does is it goes to all these components underneath it and calls all of their init functions. Let's look at all the other components that we're using for this tutorial. We've got position, geometry, material. If you look carefully at this code, you can see that there's actually two types of components. With position and geometry, you can see that we've only got one value. But for material, it looks a lot more like CSS. And why is that? That's because the material component actually has more than one property. If you go to the Aframe docs, the material component has all of these things that you can set. And to set them, you have to essentially treat the initialization like it's inline CSS. We're gonna start turning blood into a component that you can initialize with only one property. To do that, you have to go back to the schema. You have to declare what type of property it is. So when I say type, I mean like basic types like character, string, integer, array. For this example, I am gonna make the type string like this, and I'm gonna give it a default value. And for the default value, I'm gonna make it O-type, since apparently that's the most common. Let's actually prove that this works, okay? I'm gonna start by printing out this dot data. For those of you that are new to JavaScript, don't worry too much about this. Just take it as it is and it'll all come together later on. So then when I refresh it, I should get O-type. There we go. It worked. It printed out the default type of the schema. So now if we initialize it, I can go blood equals A-type. Okay. And let's see if that prints out now. Refresh this. There we go. That works. Well, we all know that blood is more than just a blood type, and it's far more complicated than that. For example, everyone's blood would be a slightly different shade depending on how much oxygen is in them. So let's try to simulate this by adding more than one properties to our component. I'm going to start by giving this blood type a name. I'm going to call it blood underscore type. And I'm going to put it around curly brackets. This. And then I'm going to add another property. So remember, each property needs a name, a type, and also a default value. So for the next one, I'm going to call it oxygen underscore level. I'm going to go with type is string again. Oops, my bad. And the default value is, of course, going to be normal. Okay,
again, I'm gonna click on print here to format everything. And there's one more thing we need to do before we test that this actually works. We're gonna, first of all, just get rid of this because it's now gonna cause a syntax error.
So now that we've got two properties, we can initialize the component just like its CSS.
So if I go blood underscore type, gonna make it a type, and then I'm gonna make oxygen underscore level, make it high. Okay.
And of course we're gonna print it out. Here I've actually written out this dot data dot oxygen and appended it to the blood type. And I do realize it's consistent to what it was several seconds ago, and that's because I started filming again and realized it wasn't actually filming, so had to delete everything, and now this is actually my second time recording. So yeah, sorry for the inconsistencies there. Let's pretty this up. So now, yeah, that's exactly what we were expecting. High A-type. The last thing we're gonna do in this lesson is actually prove that you can initialize the component to be different values for different entities. Okay, so I'm gonna copy and paste this entity. And then instead of A-type, I'm gonna make it a B-type and make the level low. Okay. And then I'm gonna change the position of the box. So instead of -2 on the x-axis, let's make it just 2 and change the color to blue because primary colors, why not? Okay, blue. Yeah, okay, there we go, that took a while. But yeah. Just as we expected, if we rerun the code now, and then you go back and run it again, you've got, first of all, high A type, and then low A B type. I'm gonna end the tutorial here and go into more depth on the next one. Thank you guys again for watching. I will see you next week. Hey guys, just a quick update. I've been super, super busy pivoting my business to focus more on AR and VR. There's gonna be a lot of new stuff coming, so please hit subscribe, like, and hit the notification bell so you can stay updated. Building the XR community on this channel really means a lot to me and brings me a lot of joy. So thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.